Hello and welcome to the editorial analysis of The Hindu. Today we shall be discussing the editorial of the 11th June. So coming to the first article, foreign policy challenges 5 years later. Now the context of this article is with regards to the challenges that are faced by India's foreign policy, or how should India's foreign policy pan out in the next 5 years for the new government is what this editorial is discussing. So coming to the issues which have been discussed, the first issue is with regards to redefining India's neighborhood. This is largely a repetition. We have discussed a lot about this policy of India, the new foreign policy. In the year 2014, stress was on India's neighborhood vis-a-vis SAARC, and again the stress this year is on India's neighborhood, but now in the context of the BIMSTEC. The Prime Minister's maiden visit is to Sri Lanka as well as to Maldives. The Foreign Minister's maiden visit is to Bhutan. All the three countries are in India's neighborhood. So the neighborhood first policy is what will continue for future, but this would specifically keep out Pakistan. So the second issue is with regards to ignoring Pakistan. The editorial discusses that, is it possible for India to continuously ignore Pakistan? And the editorial argues that this is what is not possible in the long run, primarily because India faces terrorism threats from Pakistan. So also to control this, what is important is that India should open communication with Pakistan. Also, Pakistan being the neighbor of India, being the nearest neighbor of India, complete ignoring of Pakistan is what is not in India's interest. And the editorial is rather advocating that even if backdoor diplomacy is what has to continue, even if it has to be away from media glare, this diplomacy is what should continue, and completely out ignoring Pakistan is what is not in the interest of India. Next issue is with regards to China. China is a rising power in India, in India's neighborhood, and China has made its inroads into almost all the neighbors of India and completely in South Asia, also in Indian Ocean. So in that context, India has to pan out its foreign policy in such a way that keeps in mind the China factor. And for this, the editorial is advocating that India should revive the SAARC as a counter to China's rising influence in South Asia. So that is what has been discussed. Next, what is very, very important, and in my opinion, the most important aspect that can be extracted from the editorial, it is with regards to India's neighborhood policy. Now, in this context, what you should know is that the editorial talks about several institutions which are important for India's neighborhood. This includes the SAARC, we all know, and almost every student will talk about the SAARC. Also, what is important is that you should talk about the BIMSTEC now. Also, what is important is the BPIN, which is the Bhutan, Bangladesh, India, Nepal grouping. Next, what is important is the BCIM, which is the Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar grouping. And another organization that is important is the Indian Ocean Rim Association. So if you have an opportunity, write about India's neighborhood. Try and bring about almost all these organizations. This is the way you will fetch more and more marks. So please try and do this thing as it has been done by in this particular editorial. Next, what has been discussed here is with regards to US. This is a repetition. We have discussed India-US relations just yesterday in much detail. So I will not be repeating, but just in brief, it talks about India-US relations getting strained because of Iran, the sanctions that are being imposed on India on importing oil from Iran. Also in the context of trade relations between India and US are what are stressed. Also in the context of import of S-400 defense system from Russia, US has threatened sanctions against India. Also what is important is the issue of Afghanistan. Now US is exiting Afghanistan, but this exit from Afghanistan is what is not well planned, but rather it is a rushed exit, and this might result in the revival of the Taliban, which is again not in India's interest. So this is again what is being discussed in the editorial, that this is again an irritant between India as well as US. Also, what is important is the Russia-China pole that is developing, and this might again result in a Cold War-like situation where there might be an arms race between two poles, that is Russia-China on one end and the US on the other end. So in all these backdrops, these are the major challenges of foreign policy. India will have to move ahead with in this foreign policy. So this is what is important. A question indeed vis-a-vis the challenges faced by India's foreign policy is what you can definitely expect. So from that perspective, this is what is very, very important. Coming to the next article, striking a balance. Now the context of this article is with regards to a revised circular that has been issued by the RBI. Previously, the circular was what was issued, but the Supreme Court had declared this particular circular issued in the month of February as ultra vires. We had discussed this at that point of time. For those of you who do not remember about this, you can go visit our Hindu editorial analysis mains videos of February, primarily the 12th of February. So that is where this has been discussed. Coming to the issues which are important, the first issue that is important is with regards to this circular itself. This circular is being called as the version 2.0. The name here is Prudential Framework for Resolution of Stressed Assets, and this is a new circular which has been issued by the RBI to the banks in order to ensure quicker and more efficient resolution of the non-performing assets. So this is what you should know. Also, what is important about the circular is the balance that it is trying to draw. It is drawing a balance between forcing a resolution of the stricken assets, that is the non-performing assets, as well as ensuring that the banks also get an elbow room to decide upon the NPAs. So the balance is what has been drawn between being strict with the banks, also giving freedom to the banks. So that is the balance. Next, what you should know here is with regards to the provisions that are there. Now, first and foremost, banks will have a review period of 30 days to decide on a resolution strategy. Previously, this time period that banks were getting was only 1 day. If a person was declared as a defaulter, within 1 day the banks had to decide what they have to do. So this was somehow a very less amount of time. Now the banks will have 30 days as per this new circular. Also, the banks will have the freedom to decide whether to take the defaulter to the insolvency and the bankruptcy court if the resolution has not taken place between 180 days of time limit. So the banks again have been given more power. These are the provisions which are important. In this context, also what is important is the intercreditor agreement. This is an agreement that is signed between multiple lenders. Sometimes loans are such that many banks are what I know. So this intercreditor agreement is what is going to be signed, and as a result of which all the banks will speak in a single voice. So this is what is again important here. Also, what is important here is with regards to the carrot and stick policy which has been followed by the RBI. Now, the carrot, first and foremost, the strict stick here is that if the banks are not resolving the matter, then there will be an additional penalty on the banks of 20% that will be imposed by the RBI. And the carrot here is that if the banks agree that they will take the defaulter to the insolvency and the bankruptcy court, then this penalty is what is not going to be imposed. So this is a carrot and a stick policy which the RBI has used. Next, the editorial is discussing about the section 35AA. You should know that despite the fact that this power is what has been given to the banks to decide that whether or not they should take the defaulter to the insolvency and the bankruptcy court, also the RBI also has this power. The RBI under section 35AA Act can ask the banks to can direct the banks to go ahead with the insolvency proceeding. So the power of the RBI is what has been retained, but definitely more elbow room is what has been provided to the other banks also. So this is what is important vis-a-vis this particular circular that has been issued by the RBI. Indeed, it is an important development. Question in this regard is what you can expect in General Studies Paper 3. Even if not a direct question, you might have questions on NPA, and there you must mention about this particular circular that has been issued by the RBI to resolve the issue of NPA. So that is how you have to use it, and that is the relevance. Coming to the next article, Artificial Intelligence, the Law and the Future. Now, this is an important article. The context here is with regards to artificial intelligence. Now, coming to the issues which have been discussed, first and foremost, this editorial is discussing about the presence of artificial intelligence in India. Obviously, artificial intelligence has made its presence felt in India, and the first paragraph gives us umpteen number of examples. For example, the Kerala police has inducted a robo for police work. Also in Chennai, there is a second robo-themed restaurant that has opened up. A number of artificial intelligence vehicles are also what we are seeing. And recently in Ahmedabad, what has happened is that a cardiologist performed the world's first in human robotic coronary intervention on a patient when the patient was 32 kilometers away. So all of this is what is proving that artificial intelligence is here to stay, and it is very much a part of India's functioning and India's system, India's culture now. This is what is important. Next, what is important here is with regards to the unmanageable implications that are there because of artificial intelligence. Now, what might happen here is that, for example, in the case of the surgery that is performed by this robo, it might happen that there might be a sudden loss of electricity. Then in that case, what will happen of the patient if the robo was performing the surgery and there is no doctor nearby? So there are several implications of bringing about artificial intelligence into our day-to-day life, and this calls for regulating this sector, which at present is completely unregulated. So that is what has been discussed here. Also, there are several legal issues that are associated vis-a-vis the use of artificial intelligence. For example, it might happen that a car that is self-driving car that is running on artificial intelligence might cause an accident and it might kill a human being and damage property. In that case, what is to be done? Whom will the case be filed upon? Also, can robots act as witnesses in a particular case? So these are several legal issues which need to be addressed. Another issue that has been discussed here is with regards to the regulation. Now, obviously, as we have discussed, regulation is what is required. At present, no regulation is there in India. But countries like the US and Germany have taken a lead here. A lot of regulation and actually a lot of debates on the regulation is what is taking place in these two countries. And some norms and codes are what have been laid vis-a-vis regulation of artificial intelligence. So these are the countries that India can also look up to and take help or take assistance from these countries or take ideas from them is what has been advocated. Another issue is with regards to a vacuum of legislation. Now, definitely there is no legislation on artificial intelligence as of now. What is important here is that a liability scheme be set up. That if there is any loss, then the liability will be, whose liability will it be? Will it be the liability of the manufacturer or the person using artificial intelligence? Some liability is what has to be ensured. Or another issue vis-a-vis the artificial intelligence is that of privacy. A lot of data is what is being stored in artificial intelligence, and as a result of which, privacy of citizens is what needs to be ensured. So legislation in this regard is what is warranted. Also, what cannot be denied is the benefits that India can have from artificial intelligence. If not going far ahead, if we just think about these examples, for instance, it might happen that these doctors, that these robo doctors, they can reach the remotest part of the countries. And for a country like India, where health is largely a luxury of the rich and the urban areas only, and rural areas are what are not getting these facilities, this can be a huge boom it can have immense implications, rather positive implications for India. So that is one issue that has been discussed. Also, in the context of these self-driving cars, for instance, in India, there are a number of deaths that take place. Approximately 400 deaths a day are what are taking place in India because of accidents, because of traffic accidents, and these are because of human errors. So if we have artificial intelligence, if we have robots driving these cars, then these accidental deaths are what can be reduced again. So this can again be as a benefit. So definitely artificial intelligence has benefits, and one cannot shy away from this technology coming to India. But regulation of this is what is required, legislation for this is what is required, liability is what is required, privacy protection is what is required, is what has been discussed in the editorial. Very, very important questions on artificial intelligence is something that you can anytime expect in the science section of the general studies mains or in the ethics paper also. So from that perspective, you have to prepare. And this is one article that is offering us solutions. It is offering us about the type of legislations that need to be passed. So indeed, this is very, very important. So that is the relevance of this particular article. And that's about our discussion today. Only three articles were what were important. So we will finish our discussion with the discussion of these articles. And I thank you all for watching the video.